Take me we're going to keep baptizing. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Today we have with us Miss Marley Garcia. Amen. Who's coming? Can you lift up just for a minute? Yeah, okay. Can you give a boost so we can see what you look like? Amen. 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 Somebody got their little ones to come unto me. Jesus said, amen. Amen. So today, Miss Marley Garcia, amen, in obedience to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and on confession of your faith, today we baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Religion, praise the Lord. Religion, I know I got religion. I know I got religion. I've been baptized. Oh, take me to the water.
Take me to the water.
Take me to the water. And the homegoing service is this Saturday at 11 o'clock. Amen. Here at the church. So if you please to make yourself available to come. Let's come out and support our own. Amen. Sister Lucy. Amen. 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 And Reverend Stevenson passed. I believe he used to be the pastor at Calvary Baptist Church, right? I hadn't heard on the services for him yet. Someone say what?
That's the same person.
Oh, okay. I thought it was two different people. Amen. Well, services is going to be this Saturday. Amen. We're still trying to get details on that service also, but it will be on Saturday at 11:00. Amen. 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 The choir, well, our praise team is going to go. Is going to sing for us. We got people on vacation this week. This is July, you know, is the month of vacation. People like to take vacations. Amen. Well, church, listen, we can still have worship no matter who's here. Amen. He's still worthy to be praised. Amen. 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 I'm just happy that you are a child of God today. Amen. Wake up, you woke up early this morning, and you got the activities of your limbs, you have health and strength, amen. You are just here, amen. I'm just here today, amen. That's a blessing in and of itself, amen. Amen. Praise God. And so we're going to be led in a congregational song, and after this congregational song, we'll be back with the word, amen. I'm celebrating today. I'm happy today because, of course, It is my birthday. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Amen. I'm still 50-something years old. Still 50-something years old. Yes. 35. Yes. Praise God. Praise God. I thank God for every single year. Amen. Amen. And me and my wife, we got to celebrate 22 yesterday. Year 22 on yesterday. Amen. And thank you, God, for all your wishes, prayers out to us, towards us on yesterday. Amen. We surely felt them. We're going to sing a congregational song.
Have you got good religion?
Certainly, Lord.
Have you got good religion?
Certainly, Lord.
show up no matter where you are. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you to our music ministry. Amen. For your faithfulness. Amen. Before we get into the word, amen, something I want to do this morning. I need Brother Thompson to come up front. I need Brother Anthony to come up front. Amen. Amen. This has been a long time coming. Amen. Amen. And if you don't know, church, but over a year ago, amen, the church, amen, accepted these two candidates as deacons to be ordained in our church. Over a year ago. As a matter of fact, a year ago on last Sunday, so July 18, 2020, amen, these two men were ordained into the deacon ministry. Amen. And right in the middle, and smack dab in the middle of a COVID pandemic. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We were able to come out, and the deacons were here to panelists, to be on the panel, and they did pass. Amen. But they were selected, amen, by this church congregation, amen,
amen,
to serve as deacons in this congregation. And so today I want to present them with their certificates of ordination. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And it just simply reads, having been chosen, one of good report, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, and capable of using the office well, they were set apart publicly to the office and work of deacon by the Jehovah Missionary Baptist Church on the 18th of July, 2020. And it's signed Pastor Newhouse, our chair, Marshall Douglas, our co-chair, Brother Delke Godwin, and then our deacons, Alvin Dorsey, who was counsel Little Gilbert Anderson, and our counsel, Samuel Pickens. Amen.
Amen.
And so I want to present this certificate to you, Brother John Earl, Deacon John Earl Thompson.
Amen.
We certainly thank the Lord for you. Deacon Anthony Jerome Smith, we certainly thank the certificate for you to have, and the treasure, and hopefully you treasure that, and you treasure the calling. The key word on that certificate is that that you are led by the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. The key word for you as Christians, amen, is that we are only, and myself, we are only who we are. We can only be who we can be, and it's because of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Amen. And so when you look at them, when you look at me, and when you see, or if you can recall my flaws, amen. If you can recall all of my mistakes, if you look at me and all you see is my mistakes, you're looking at the wrong thing.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. And you should be looking at the spirit that's inside of me, that's driving me, amen, that's changing me from the inside out, amen?
Amen.
So we're blessed to have these two men and all of our deacons, amen, who serve faithfully and they serve well at Jehovah Missionary Baptist Church, amen? Let's bless the Lord for these two young men, amen, young men, amen, as unto the Lord, not unto man, because
amen,
your reward comes from God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. In the book of Luke. In the book of Luke. In your Bibles to Luke. Go to chapter 14. Luke chapter 14. Amen. Y'all might get out. We might get out about 2 minutes early today. Amen. Moving right along.
All right.
When you get to Luke 14, put your finger on verse 25. Of course, if you didn't order, Mr. Mike back there is going to put it up there on the screen for you also. Amen. Thank God for the technology. And those who can work. Amen. We're going to read this all the way down to verse 33. Well, we're going to read it all the way down to 35. Let's read the whole stanza. It says this, and I'm reading from the, right out of the King James Bible. It says, there went a great multitude with him, and he turned and he said to them, if any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Verse 28. For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it? Lest, happily, after he had laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold it shall begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Amen. Or what king going to make war against another king, sitteth not down first and consulteth whether he be able with 10,000 to meet him that cometh against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is yet a great way off, he sendeth an embassage and desireth conditions of peace. So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. I'm going to read the verse, these last verses just for fun. And salt is good, but if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land nor yet for the dunghill. But men cast it out. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Lord, we thank you. We bless you, God.
Bless you, God.
We thank you, Lord, thank for you. Your word. Thank you, God, again, for watching over us this week, for protecting us, leading us, and guiding us, God.
Yes, God.
Providing for us, God. Making a way, God. Opening doors. All what you do, God, in the background that we don't even know, Lord, you're doing, Lord. We just want to say thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Lord, who paid the price for our sin, God. Died on the cross, Father, and conquered death in the grave, and rose, Father, with power, with all power in his hand, and he is seated right now at your right hand, Father, in a position of authority, God. We're thankful for all of his passion that he had for us in the sacrifice, Lord, and the victory that comes through his death, burial, and resurrection. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that lives within us, God, to lead us and guide us, to remind us, Lord, the things that we have learned about Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit, and we pray, Lord, that you would, that your Holy Spirit would remind us and lead us even right now, that you would give us new revelations as we preach your word. I do pray for a preaching boldness, clarity, and power. Make it plain, God, that someone, that everyone that hears, God, would hear, would understand, God, what you are saying to them on today, how you are speaking to the church on today.
Yes,
we give you glory for that,
God,
because you do it every time. God, we thank you for the one, God, that was baptized today.
Thank you.
Wrap her up in your arms, God. And Father, send your ministry angels, God, to continue to minister in her young life.
Yes,
God, we thankful for the young ones that come, Lord. Help us to have, those of us who are seasoned, God, may we have hearts of little ones that come running to you, Father. God, we thank you, God, because you're still, Father, showing up, God, in the lives of boys and girls and men and women. And so we thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Send your word. Let it accomplish what you have purposed for it on today. We give you praise. We give you honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And you may be seated in the presence of God. Still continuing our mission. The mission. Sermon series. And today we want to talk about making Christ number one. Making Jesus Christ number one. Before we get into the message, amen. We want to look at the definition of a disciple, of a kingdom disciple. Amen. We try to look at this every Sunday, amen, so that we can commit this thing to our self-conscious memory. Amen. Amen. Every day. So a kingdom disciple is, let's read it together, a believer in Christ who takes part in the spiritual developmental process of progressively learning to live all of life in submission to Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what we're doing. We're learning every day how to live all of our lives in submission to Jesus Christ. Amen. The Sunday school scholars, amen, understand the importance of doing that, of why we would do that, amen. Because of the major price that was paid for us at Calvary's cross. A great price was paid for us. A sacrifice happened that we might not die, but that we may live eternally with God. Amen. A great price was paid while we didn't deserve to be paid for.
Yes, sir.
While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Thank you.
While we were yet still out there ignoring the calling on your life, Christ died for you. While you were still running away, doing your own thing, living your life, living your best life, Christ died for you. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And so when we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we take the next step. We just don't stand and just say, I'm a Christian.
All right.
That's great that you are a Christian, that you have eternal life. But you understand now that something pushes you into something better than what was before. Something should push you to live differently than how you were living before Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The grace of God pushes us to live for Jesus Christ. Pushes us to talk right. It pushes us to act right, to treat one another right, to love your neighbor. The grace of God, what he has done for me, pushes me to be and to live and try to submit my life, to live all of my life under Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So we're going to talk about making Jesus Christ number one today. Making him number one. The good news about being a disciple of Jesus Christ is that when you give God your first and your best, God will give you his first and his best.
Amen,
somebody. When you give your best, then God will give his best.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
He knows just how to take care of you. Amen. In your time of need, when you make God and his kingdom your priority,
yes, sir,
you can trust him to take care of everything in your life. When you put him first.
Amen.
Amen. That's what Matthew 6:33 is all about. When he says, to seek ye first the kingdom of God.
Yes, sir.
His righteousness.
Yes.
And then I'll take care of all of that other stuff.
Amen.
The things that you normally worry about, he says, that stuff I'll take care of. You don't have to worry no more how it's going to get done, because I'm going to get it done for you.
Amen.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We can trust him. So in order to live a life as a kingdom disciple, we will have to learn how to put Jesus first.
Right.
Someone say, put Jesus first.
Put Jesus first.
So today's text begins by helping us see this need to just truly trust God, trust the Father, trust the Son. Amen.
Amen.
And Jesus spells this out in this text, and the true cost. He gives us the true cost of really following him. We looked at the cost on last week. Amen. We began to look at that on last week, and we talked about keeping your focus. You remember, we got to be able to stay focused as a disciple.
Amen.
Amen. Looking at keeping our eyes on the prize. Amen. And not all around us, because it'll throw us off. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let me just put this in for free. Some of us are focusing on the wrong things.
Right.
Amen. Some of you are focusing on me.
Amen.
And your focus should not be on me.
Sir.
On your neighbor.
on your mother, your father, your sister, your brother, your uncle, your auntie, your grandpa, your grandma.
Amen.
Your children. You got your focus on the wrong person.
Amen.
Like this, when we had to plow. In order to plow, we have to be straight. We have to have our vision straight on the right object, and we're supposed to go towards that object.
Wow.
Yes, amen. We're not supposed to be looking this way when we're on the gospel plow. Amen. And let me drop this warning. Be careful. We talked about this on Wednesday night. Be careful what you have your focus on, because that focus can be the very thing that destroys you, that takes you to your demise, or causes you to fall. That's what happened to Lot's wife.
Yeah, right.
Lot's wife was focused on the wrong thing. She couldn't help. She couldn't help but to. Even though she was warned, don't do it.
Yeah.
And the thing about that story is, I love about that story is, they were going to Zoar, and because God said, listen, we can go to that city, and the angel agreed that when you get to Zoar, you're going to be saved. I can't do nothing until you get there. I can't destroy nothing until you get there. And right when they got right, the Bible said, right when Lot got there, amen, that's when the destruction started happening. The thing what happened with Lot's wife is she was supposed to be up there, but she was back here, behind Lot.
All right.
Amen. She was lagging behind. You know how people, you got to tell your kids when you're in the mall, you look, get on up here. Can somebody take you? I can't watch you back there. You ain't staying back there. Get up here watching. Lot's wife was back here lagging. Amen. And the angel specifically said, I cannot do that till you get there. As soon as he got there, destruction, brimstone, and fire. Lot's wife was back there, like this. And got caught up. Be careful what you're looking at. Be careful where you have your focus, because that can take you out.
Yes, sir.
But if you focus on Jesus Christ, you're good. You're safe. Amen, somebody. Should nothing take you away from Jesus Christ? Your focus. Not nobody. And that's what this text is about today. Let's read that again. It says, large crowds were coming to him. This is verse 25 and 26. And he turned and he said to them, if anyone comes to me, does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, then they cannot be my disciple.
Yeah.
This text makes a lot of people cringe. Huh. Amen. When they hear this. But that's because they're taking it and they're misinterpreting what Jesus is saying.
Yes, sir.
Amen. This one test that you can always put in the Bible, on the Bible, is if you read something and it just don't sound great, like this right here, I hate my mama, my daddy, sister, brother. This thing, use logic.
That's right.
Do you think Jesus really wants you to hate your mother, father, sister, brother? One test that you put against the Bible is if it sounds like it's contradicting itself, then it probably means something else. Because the Bible teaches us to honor our father. Honor your mother in the Lord. Amen? Because this is right, and you will live long.
Yes, sir.
So why in the world would he come back and say you need to hate them? I mean, this means something else. Amen, somebody.
Yeah.
This must mean something else.
Yeah.
Couldn't he just say, listen, just follow me.
All right.
I don't need you to follow me. He could have just said, love me more than anything else. But he didn't say that. He said what he said. So we need to ask what it means about hating family. So the key to understanding this is to know that, listen, Jesus is not talking about our affections.
Amen.
How we feel.
Amen. Amen.
A lot of us, we do a lot of stuff off of how we feel.
Yes, sir.
And our feelings get us in some trouble.
Yes, sir.
Our feelings take us places where we don't want to go. We wasn't intended to go that far as that. Amen.
Amen.
But he's not talking about your affections, amen, how we feel. He's talking about our decisions.
Right.
What we do. So he's saying that when we come to a decision in our life and our family disagrees with Christ's decision, amen, then your family has to give way to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Because Jesus Christ trumps all.
Yes, sir.
Simple as that, amen.
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 And so again, the issue on the floor then is authority. So we'll say authority.
Authority.
Authority. You and I must be willing to put him ahead of even the most precious people in our lives.
Yeah.
If we're going to really follow Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because he would not be number two in anybody's heart.
Amen.
And on a side note, listen. If you follow Jesus Christ, if you are making him number one in your life, then that's going to benefit whoever you come in contact with.
Yeah.
Whoever is in your circle.
Yes, sir.
If I put him before my wife, that's going to benefit my wife.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If she's putting them before me, that's going to benefit me.
Yes, sir.
That's going to hurt me.
Amen.
But guess what? If we do it together, woo, Lord have mercy.
Amen.
The Bible talks about being unequally yoked. That's one of them. Amen. You got one striving, you got one way. You got one sitting still, you got one trying to follow Jesus. And you get the conflict because I'm trying to follow Jesus Christ, not you. And plus, you're not trying to follow me, now I'm mad at you. But if we can be equally yoked, then guess what? We're both chasing Jesus Christ. Oh, my goodness.
Amen.
I think that was freaking alone. So the issue here is authority. Let me give you this example. Suppose I say to my wife, I just told you we've been married 22 years. We've been married 22 years. Suppose I say to Quetta, listen, if another woman comes into my life, then you have to step aside and you need to be second priority to her. How do you think she's going to respond to that? You think she don't accept that condition? Huh? Husband, wife, your husband come up to you and say, listen, all right, there may be a second woman coming in. I need you to step back. You're second and she's first. Let's go. Are you going to just fall in?
No, sir.
I ain't trying to start, man. She would accept it. You know why? Because she don't deserve to accept it. Amen. She deserves to be the only woman in my life. Because I made that decision when I decided to marry her. That she would be the only one. Are you hearing me? When I married her. You see, the nature of the marriage commitment means that everybody else is number two. No one should question me if I put my spouse first when making decisions involving our time together. Amen, somebody. And likewise, nobody should ever question you if you put God in your life first. Nobody should have to question that. Amen, somebody. Even ahead of your family, nobody should have to question whether or not you got God first. So my brothers and sisters, there's nothing in my life that deserves my commitment, my passion, more than my love for Jesus Christ. It's to be so high above my love for anything else, that it may look like I hate them, amen, when I put his will and his desire and his direction first. It may appear that way, amen, somebody. It may look like I hate you, amen. But I don't hate you, amen. It may look like I don't want to hang out with you no more. But anyway, I don't hate you. I don't dislike you anymore. I just love Jesus more.
Right.
And if my love for Jesus causes you to fall away, then I, bye.
Harsh.
Amen. So I am not trying to be too harsh. Amen. Amen. But listen, if you have anything or anybody dictating your direction more than God, dictating your decisions more than God, then you are out of alignment. Amen.
Amen.
Not a kingdom of disciples. You have put your hand to the plow and you have looked backwards, you looked sideways, you looked all over the place. But not to the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And so, my brothers and sisters, listen. God's kingdom must come first. His will must come first. His word must be first. Amen?
Amen.
Or we'll be just simply missing the mark when it comes to following Jesus. So, the question that we have to ask today is this. Is Christ number one in your life? Answer here. That's a personal evaluation. You need to ask yourself that question. Is Christ number one in my life? Amen. 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 My brother, and if you choose, listen, if you have to choose between Jesus and anyone else, make sure you choose Jesus every single time.
Amen. Amen.
Because he chose you.
Amen.
We just talked about it at the beginning of the sermon.
Yes, sir.
Choose Jesus every time. Because he chose you. And you wouldn't even worth being chosen.
Amen.
I wouldn't even worth being chosen. But he still died for me. He chose to still die.
Amen.
Yes. Amen, somebody. Yes. And God, it ain't according to my how I feel. Y'all better be glad I'm not Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Amen. I would be a good Jesus. Amen. And then y'all be calling me Jesus. Y'all taking me away from the message. So discipleship demands a willingness to put God's rules first. Look at Luke 14:27. Luke 14:27. Jesus says this. He says, whoever does not carry his own cross and comes after me cannot be my disciple. And then look at Luke 9:23. Luke 9:23 says, if anyone wishes to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. Someone say daily.
Daily.
So then let's talk about what it means to carry the cross. What does it mean to carry the cross? Because it's mentioned in both of those texts. Crucifixion. Crucifixion was the favorite means of execution for the Romans back in the days. They would tie. I should have brought the cross out here so I can give you a good visual. They would tie the man's arms, the convicted man's arms, to the horizontal pole. They would attach it to the horizontal part of the cross. And then that man would have to carry that horizontal heavy bar down the streets of the town. People lined up on the right and on the left, watching him carry that his own cross all the way up to the place of crucifixion. All right. All right. Jesus had to do the same thing. He had to carry his own cross all the way through Jerusalem. People watching him, spitting on him, mocking him. All the way up to Calvary, the place of crucifixion. The Romans, they made the criminal do this publicly. They had to carry the cross. They wanted everybody to see. And they did it because they wanted them to know. They wanted the people to know that Rome was right. And this man was wrong. That cross, it was a convicted man's, it was his death sentence. It was his indictment. Amen. Saying to the people that were on the path that he was worthy of death because the Roman government had found him guilty. Jesus says this, my brothers and sisters. He said that we have to carry the cross. We need to carry our cross daily.
Yes, sir.
We need to be on public display.
Yeah. All right.
Daily. Come on, somebody. He wants us to so identify with him that when we are accused of being a Christian,
right,
we say, I'm guilty.
All right.
I'm a
Amen.
Christian. Amen. Amen. I'm a follower of him. When we're accused of loving God and fellowshipping with the Lord Jesus Christ, we accept all of the charges. Amen. Yeah, you're right. I'm one of them. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. I'm guilty as charged. Amen, somebody. That's one of the things it means to take up your cross. It means to be, it means that if your family and friends, listen, don't want you to be identified with Jesus Christ. And you say, well, that's all right. Go ahead and do your thing. I'm going to be identified with Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You will stand and you will identify with Jesus Christ. It means that if your standards cause people to fall out of your life, so be it. Jesus said, Jesus wants me to follow him.
Amen.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
He wants you, he wants me to follow him.
Amen.
Nobody else.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Somebody say, nobody else.
Nobody else.
Amen. You gotta get with it then.
Yeah.
But there's one other thing about this cross. It's very, very, very key. When someone carried their cross through town, guess what? It was a one-way journey.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
You were on your way to die. I don't care how much he wanted to turn around and go back. He couldn't do that.
Amen.
He had to go all the way.
Amen.
It was for sure what was about to happen. Are you here? He was on his place of execution. Jesus said, when you take up the cross daily, listen, he was not talking about you dying a physical death.
All right.
Because you can't die a physical death but one time. So get that out your mind.
Yeah.
Well, he's talking about you having a daily, a day-by-day walk with him, and a day-by-day identification with him. A day-by-day, amen, day where I said, no more of me, but all of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I'm going to identify with him daily, not just on Sundays.
Amen.
I'm not going to just carry my cross on Sunday, but tomorrow, when I wake up, guess what? I'm going to pick it back up, and I'm going to walk with him. I'm not ashamed for people to know that I belong to Jesus Christ. And you should not be ashamed either. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Denying yourself. That's what he's talking about. It don't just mean you giving up something that you like. It means that you are saying no to your desires and you're saying yes to his. So that you would know his will in your life. That's what Romans 12:2 is all about. Be not conformed to his will, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may know his good and perfect will.
Amen.
What his good and perfect will is, you know, that's how you know his will, because you are in his will.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And so it means that we have to funnel all of our decisions through the filter of God. We don't just do things off the fly. You got a decision, take it through the filter. Put it through. Put that decision through the filter. Amen. And then if it comes out, then God must have wanted, God has approved. Amen. Or at least he'll change it to where it needs to be. Once it's filtered, it may go in as dirty and cloggy, but once it goes through God, it comes out clean.
Yes, sir.
But this is, my brothers and sisters, this is how we see now why there's so many Christians, but there's not a lot of disciples.
Right.
Because listen, discipleship is not a club. Discipleship is not a clique that you join.
Right.
Amen, somebody. But a discipleship it means I'm a full-on, no holds barred commitment to Jesus Christ. And everything in my life, amen, is going to be committed to him. Everything that I am is going to be Jesus Christ. That's how you let him take care of stuff. And you say, I'm giving you everything.
Amen.
When you surrender, amen, you can't just surrender with just one hand. You gotta give it up.
Yes, sir.
Amen. This is a little side note. We coming back from Dallas yesterday, going out to eat. I was going just a little bit too fast. He said I was going 90. I wasn't going 90. I know I wasn't going 90. Our five of us was going the same speed, but he said I was a ringleader. pulled me over. Thank God, you know, we got a warning. Amen. Got a warning. Amen. And I always joke around. I say to my wife, if I ever get pulled over by a cop, guess what? I ain't surrendering. I'm getting out of the car. I'm just going to take off running. They ain't going to get me. They just going to open the door and take off running. They catch me. Even for a speed ticket. Amen. Amen. But listen. But that's the business. A lot of us don't know how to surrender. And we're just running. We'd rather run than surrender. And we don't know that running is going to get us in more trouble. When you're running, you're just running away from your, come on, somebody.
Amen.
But if you surrender, yeah. See, we surrender. My wife, she was quick. It's our anniversary. And we got partying. We partying this stuff. And as soon as y'all went down there, it's our anniversary. Amen. We didn't get out for the morning, praise God. Amen. So, Jesus gave us two illustrations that I want to look at, and then we'll try to get this thing off. In verses 28 and 32, he gives us two illustrations. Let's read 28 and 30. Verse 28 and 30 in Luke 14. The first three verses here, in verse 28 and 30, he says, he's talking about a builder. You see that? Amen. We have that on the screen. Thank you, sir. For which of you intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first to count the cost, whether he has sufficient to finish it? Verse 29. Lest happily after he had laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold it began to mock him. Verse 30. Saying this man began to build and was not able to finish. 31. Amen. Did I say 31? Let's stop right there at 30. Stop at 30. So listen. Here we get this importance of giving up all of your claims. He talks about this first builder who has to, he says, calculate the cost of the project that he's on. He's building a house. Listen, nobody who builds puts down a foundation of a building only to discover that they underestimated the cost so badly that they can't finish the project. They count the cost of what it takes to lay that foundation right. Just enough. Not much, not too much, not too less. They count the cost of what it's going to cost them to build up on that foundation to make sure they got it all covered. So that they can start the project and they can finish all the way to completion. Amen. Amen. Jesus is saying that this being his disciples involves some planning. It involves some calculation on our part. We have to plan to follow Jesus.
All right.
Listen to how that sounds. You and I must plan to follow Jesus. Count the cost. Listen, I can preach on discipleship, amen, and somebody can say, listen, Pastor G, I agree, I'm with you right there, I'm excited, I'm going to be a disciple. Jesus says, hold up, add up the cost.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wait a minute, get out your spiritual calculator.
All right.
Add that cost up, make sure you have enough spiritual investment that it takes to finish.
All right.
Not just start. You have to evaluate whether or not there's anything in your life that's hindering you from being his disciple. You can count the cost. Because I don't need you to start and don't get it at the finish.
Right.
Are you hearing me? I'm trying to make it as plain as I can, amen. And then the second illustration in verse 31 and 32, he gives us an illustration of a king who's on his way to fight another king. He says, oh, or what king going to make war against another king, sitteth not down first and consulteth with him, whether or not he's able to, with 10,000, to meet him that is coming against him with 20,000. The next verse. Or else, while the other is yet a great way off, he sendeth an ambassador and he desires a condition of peace. Listen, so you got 10,000 with one king, and the other has 20,000. And the first king is smart enough to pause and consider whether or not this thing is worth it. He got, right. You got 10 more thousand men than I do. I need to rethink this thing. And if I don't think I can get out of this thing alive, then I'm going to send somebody to make peace.
All right.
Amen.
Yeah.
I'm going to make a deal. But the point here in this thing is, listen, there's no neutral stance.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because the king either has to fight or he has to make a deal. There's no other deal, no other way. He can't just sit there staring in his face. Because if he does that, his army is going, they're going to get demolished.
Yeah.
He has to make a decision. Amen?
Amen.
It's important for every potential disciple to consider the cost of being a disciple, of following Jesus Christ. Nevertheless, those who choose to reject and resist God, they should also count the cost. So I got to count the cost if I'm going to follow him.
Yeah.
But then I need to really count the cost if I choose not to follow him.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Because what good can come from opposing God?
Yeah.
God says, yes, it will cost me something to follow Jesus Christ, to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. But listen, it will cost you even more if you reject him. Some of y'all might say, oh, I wish I didn't have to hear that. I didn't know. I don't want to hear that, Master G. Why did he say that to us? Because the Bible simply tells us, listen, choose you this day.
Yes, sir.
Who are you going to serve?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
You're going to serve God or going to serve man?
Amen.
But no, whatever you choose, count the cost.
Yeah.
Because it's going to cost you something to follow me, God said. But it's going to cost you something to follow if you don't follow me, too.
Amen.
I forgot to tell you that again. This is not going to make you shout today. In closing, though, look what Jesus says. He talks about that nobody can be my disciple, verse 33, who does not give up his own possessions. And he talks about salt. Salt that's lost its taste, his saltiness has become tasteless. Cannot season anymore, talk about it. When the salt loses its saltiness, you can't use it. Amen? And he says, it's useless. It ain't good for nothing but for the manure pile.
Yeah.
Just thrown out. And he says, let those who hear have it. Let them who have ears hear. That's our accountability. Because when we hear the word of God, he would say, let them hear. Hear, that second hear is let them apply. Hear and apply.
All right, right.
Amen.
Amen.
So Jesus is telling us today, listen, he can't really use people. He cannot use people who are not willing to make him number one. Why? Because he will only share his authority with those who are willing to do four things. Show that slide that says Jesus shares, Tony. Jesus shares. He's only willing to share his authority with you. I'm willing to do four things. Number one, those who are loving him supremely. He's willing to share his authority with those, number two, who are ready to carry the cross daily. Those who are not afraid to be identified publicly as a follower of Jesus Christ, who's not afraid to be guilty, called guilty of being a Christian. Number three, those who have counted the cost. He will share his authority with them. Those who have counted the cost. Amen, somebody. And then number four, those who will put him first.
Amen.
To share his authority, my brothers and sisters, is the reward of being a disciple. To share in his authority. That's the reward. When you are his disciples, your reward is you get to share in his authority.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen. And he said, at the beginning, we said that the deacons read off the scriptures today. He says, all authority in heaven and earth belongs to me, was given to me by my Father. Yeah. And guess what, my brothers and sisters? Now he wants us, amen, to make duplicates of his authority. He wants us to become duplicates of his authority. Then he wants us to go out and make others to make duplicates of that authority.
Amen.
To make disciples. Amen. To grow his authority. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Because when you're a disciple, listen, you get to piggyback off of divine authority. Amen. You get to ride on the back of Jesus Christ and his power, his authority.
Amen.
In your life. You get to piggyback on that thing. Amen. If you're a Christian, listen, you have not yet, and you're not even a disciple yet, then you are on your way of heaven. You're on your way to heaven, but you may not be experiencing much of heaven right now.
Yes, sir.
You're on your way to heaven, but heaven ain't really doing nothing for you right now. You're just waiting to get to heaven. Faith alone gives us eternal life, amen? But becoming a visible follower of Jesus Christ brings eternal life to your everyday experience as you share in his authority. Let me leave you with this example. My wife, again, I'm using her all day today. Some of you know, many of you know, my wife Jaquetta played basketball at OU. Amen. She was a 4-year veteran woman. Scholarship. Had her paid. They had to pay a penny to go to school. She was blessed. When you go to OU, to the Lloyd Noble Center, they got this place called the Legacy Center. Or the Legacy Court, they call it. Amen. The Legacy Court, put that up, Tony, is a place that's in the Lloyd Noble Center. It's a museum-like exhibit that chronicles the history of basketball at OU. It features the men and women programs and their most prominent players and coaches and all of their accomplishments. When you go to the Lloyd Noble Center to the Legacy Center, guess what? When you walk around there, you're going to find a picture of Jaquetta Hurley in that center. Matter of fact, you're going to be on that second floor. When you walk around the concourse in the arena, if you just walk in to go get you some concession stand, in the arena, you'll see her picture posted on the side. Amen. Amen. She had a great career. Listen, when we get, we get to go to the game. Every now and then, we want to go see a game. And she will call in and she'll get us free tickets to go see the women play. To get the free tickets, guess what? She has to, all she has to do is call them, tell them who she is, how many tickets she wants. And they get them for her. They reserve them. Now, in order to get the free tickets, she can't give them my name. We can't give them my name. Because they don't know my name. Are you hearing me? They don't know my name. We must use her name to get the free tickets. When we get to the game, everyone else enters through general admission to get their tickets. But when we get there, we get to pick ours up at a place called Roll Call. At the Roll Call booth, they have this list with a bunch of names on it. And her name will be on that list, along with how many tickets she needs and who they're going to. Amen, somebody. We're able to skip the lines and go straight to the ticket. Not because of who I was, but because of who she was. My name was not on the roll call list because of who I am. It was on there because of who she was. And then when we get to our assigned seats, they good seats. Amen. We can sit up close. We can see all the action. Amen. 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 But listen, we didn't get those good seats because they knew me. We got them because they knew her. Some of y'all are going to get it in a minute. One time we went to a game, listen, and when the game was over, they allowed us to go down on the court through the tunnel where the players come out, back to the players' locker room. We got to sit back there with all of the current players' parents. The coaches was back there. All the players. We were surrounded by the team. My girl got to touch players, talk to players, got to talk to the head coach. Woo, listen. They didn't give us all that access to that area, to that restricted area because of who I am. But it was only because of who she was. Because they knew her, they accepted me. Are you hearing me? When she okayed me, they okayed me. Are you hearing me? Come on, somebody. That whole night activity took place not because of who I was, but it took place all because of who she was. What are you trying to say, Pastor? My brother and sister. Jesus says this, if you become my disciples, you get to piggyback on all of my authority. You get to piggyback on all of my rights and all of my privileges that belong to me. When you become my disciple, my authority is transformed on you. And when I accept you, they'll accept. I wish I had some help here. When you become my disciple, I'll open some doors that you can't even open. You didn't even know existed. When you become my disciple, I'll seat you in prominent places that you're not even qualified to sit in. When you become my disciple, I'll surround you by prominent people. I wish I had some help. I'll put people around you. When you become my disciples, you'll get access to some things that you didn't have access to. And it's not because of you, but it's because of me. So why would you want to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? Come on, somebody. We're talking about staying under that covenant covering, that blood covenant that has so many privileges. Not because of what you are or what I've done, but it's all because of what Jesus done. And when we stay connected, guess what? Listen, we can take back all day long on Jesus Christ. Allow him to carry me all over the place.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
Every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm done. Lord, thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For your word, for your son, Jesus Christ. You've given God to us that we may. That we may trust in him, that we may believe in him, Lord, and then that we may have eternal life.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for the eternal life that comes from Lord Jesus Christ, for receiving him. Well, God, we thank you for the call of discipleship, that call us to even move a little bit further, a little bit closer.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
And to begin to pattern our lives after Jesus Christ.
Yes.
So, Father, I pray for my brother and I pray for my sister, God, that every day, Lord, we would be focused on him, that we would be willing, God, to put him first in all of our lives, that we would count the cost every single day, that we would carry our cross and be so identified with him every single day, everywhere we go, God.
Yes, Lord.
That men and women would know, God, that, Lord, that we are yours.
Yes, God.
We are followers of Jesus Christ.
Yes,
help us, God, to pattern our lives, channel our decisions, Lord, through Jesus Christ. Lord, that we may, Lord, share in the authority that comes from being a follower of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
And I thank you, God, because somebody is making that decision for the first time today.
Thank you.
And we rejoice, God.
Yes, God.
Someone is receiving your son, Jesus Christ, in their heart today.
Yes, Lord.
We rejoice, God, with the angels.
Yes,
someone is grabbing back on to the plow, holding on to that plow, Father.
Yes, God.
And they decide, I'm not going to let go this time. I'm going to go. I'm not going to just start, but I'm going to start and I'm going to finish this race. No matter who don't go with me, I'll go.
Yes, Lord.
My mother don't have to go, but I'll go. My father don't have to go, but I'll go.
Yes, God.
I have to go by myself.
Yes, Lord.
So God, I thank you.
Thank you.
For the call of discipleship.
Thank you.
Let those who have ears to hear.
Yes, God.
Let them hear on today.
Yes, God.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Maybe you have not yet. If you've given your life to Jesus Christ, if today is the first day that you said, Lord, come into my heart. Just put your hand in the air. We want to receive you into the family of God today. Amen. Praise God. Amen. If you, I don't see any visitors in the house, but if there is, this case I don't see. If you're looking for a church home, listen, our doors are open to receive you as a family member of Jehovah Missionary Baptist Church. Amen. And if you are looking for a church home, just wave your hand and we'll receive you as a member today. We can't do the right hand fellowship. I can't hug you in. Amen. But if you are looking for a church home, we would love to be your church family. Amen. That you just wave your hand. Amen. Praise God. If it's on your heart to rededicate your life to God, to say, Lord, picking up the gospel plow today, Lord, and I'm not going to let go this time. I'm going to see what the end holds for me. I'm going to follow you all the way. That's you today, that you want to rededicate your life. Just put your hand in the air. Amen. We acknowledge you and we'll just say a prayer for you on today. Praise God. Praise God. Lord, we see that there is none, God. Lord, we know, God, there is plenty of room in the kingdom of God. Thank you, Lord, for your word. God, it will accomplish what you have purposed, God. So thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Someone give God a hand clap of praise today. I'm sorry, I keep going that I want you. Amen, amen, amen. But I pray that this word will be a help for you this week. Amen. That it will help you in your walk, your daily walk with Jesus Christ. That's all we want to accomplish.
Amen.
To be able to help somebody. Amen. Live a life that's pleasing to God. That's all we're trying to accomplish. Amen. Look at them. Amen. Because if we can all get there, amen. What a glorious day. What a glorious time we'll have. Not only down here, but when we get to heaven, it's going to be great in heaven also. Amen. Let's stand. We'll be dismissed. Remember on this Saturday, again, the funeral will be here at 11 o'clock. Please, if you're available, come out and support. Amen. We will need the kitchen committee on duty. Amen. Kitchen committee, you need to be on duty to prepare lunches for them to take with them after the funeral. Amen. Amen. Best God. God, we thank you for what our eyes have seen, what our ears have heard. Now, Father, just walk with us, talk with us all day long today and for the rest of this week. Help us, Lord, as we try our best, Lord, to live for you, to follow Jesus Christ. Even when we mess up, God, we thank you. We're thankful, Lord, that you forgive us and you give us another chance, God. You're not a God that will leave us or forsake us. You said you'll be there all the way to the end. So God, I thank you, Lord, that promise is still true today. Now, Lord, as we leave this place, I pray, God, that we would do better than we did last week. We will love a little better than we did last week. That we will be a better example of the believer this week than we were last week. That we will run the enemy out of our lives, Lord, that he will be able to make no decisions in our lives this week. None whatsoever. None. He will not have anything to do with our lives this week. And we'll be all in for Jesus this week.
Yes,
we thank you, God.
Thank you.
We thank you. We bless you.
Bless you.
In Jesus' name. Go with us as we leave this place. Keep us safe. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Go in peace. I love you. I love you, my brother. I love you, my sister.